It's really a pleasure for me to welcome you all to the first talk in our annual lecture series, which starts a bit later this year, but with a fabulous lineup of speakers and, as usual, a wide range of topics and disciplinary views on the constitution, evolution, and transmission of knowledge in its different forms. I'm especially delighted that our first guest this year is Shadi Bartsch-Zimmer, who is one of gloknos' godparents, so to speak. Professor Bartsch is the Helen A. Regenstein Distinguished Service Professor of Classics at the University of Chicago, where she also leads the Stefanovich Institute on the Formation of Knowledge as its inaugural director. And in this capacity, she also serves as the first editor of its recently established journal, No, which is a wonderful cross-disciplinary outlet that we regularly advertise to our members and that I encourage everyone to submit to. If you are looking for an open-minded journal to showcase innovative and robust research on the history of knowledge. Many of you will of course be familiar with Professor Bartsch's contributions to the field of classics, especially through her work on the ancient novel, Neronian literature, political theatricality, and Stoic philosophy. Following her award-winning book on the Roman Stoic poet Perseus, and an edited volume on Seneca, among other publications. She just published last year a new translation of Virgil's The Aeneid with a wonderful book cover, a translation that has been praised as the best version of the epic in modern English. More recently, Professor Bartsch has been investigating the reception of the Western classical tradition in contemporary China, with notably a very interesting paper that came out a few months ago in the journal History and Theory, on the diverging conceptions of rationality being debated between Chinese and Western philosophers, and how the framing of the debate on the basis of what appears to be an essentialist binary of instrumentalism versus spirituality serves political and ideological purposes more than any fundamental understanding of either present-day Chinese or Western culture and society. And in that paper, Max Weber was the core Western figure whose text had traveled to China, whereas today Professor Bartsch will discuss the Chinese reception of Leo Strauss, another influential and iconic scholar from the University of Chicago. I very much look forward to listening to you, Shadi, and I want to take this opportunity to thank you also for your generous support of gloknos from the very beginning. I hope that we will have the opportunity to welcome you in Cambridge very soon. But in the meantime, I'm really glad that we are able to organize this talk online and disseminate it to a much wider audience than we would have had had you been here physically with a much reduced core of supporters and fans of your work. So before I hand over to Shadi, I just want to say a few words about the format of the session. Professor Bartsch will speak for about 40 to 45 minutes, and then we will move to the Q&A session with the audience. So if you have any questions, please type them in the chat box during or after the talk, and we will address as many as we can during the session. And otherwise, Professor Bartsch is happy to answer any questions that you might want to submit to her via email. Shadi, welcome again, and the floor is yours.
Thank you so much, Inanna, and thank you for hopefully increasing the subscription to Know, our journal. Good evening, everybody, and thank you so much for zooming in. I'm honored to be speaking at gloknos' annual lecture series, and I'd like to add my special thanks, of course, to the director, Inanna Hamati-Ataya, for the invitation, and to Samantha Peel for her technical expertise. The title of my talk today is Strauss in Beijing. This may sound a bit esoteric, even if delivered at an institute dedicated to the exchange and use of forms of knowledge. It might also sound odd coming from a classicist. In actuality, as I hope to convince you, the reception of the political theorist Leo Strauss in China provides a window into some of the most fundamental developments in Chinese intellectual discourse over the past 20 years. The very period in which presidents Hu Jintao and Xi Jinping have advocated for an increasingly central role for China in the world political economy once dominated by the United States. Even more dramatically, looking at what intellectuals are doing with Leo Strauss at major Chinese universities in Beijing and Shanghai also lets us see how the classical texts of Western antiquity have been co-opted into the Chinese intellectual tradition to support the government to decry Western modernity and to define the role of the Chinese intellectual within the autocratic state. Now, for most of us who are not Strauss specialists, myself included, the first thing his name evokes, especially in the US, is his supposed influence over the Republican foreign policy apparat under Reagan and Bush, some of whom apparently thought they were members of an enlightened class guiding America through the so-called crisis of the West, a group that the New York Times called the Leo conservatives. And I'm going to start sharing my screen now, which after a year's worth of practice, I think I can do. Okay, good. Let's move on to the Leo conservatives. Okay. On the Leo conservatives' view, it was not in the country's best interest for people to know the ministrations of the upper echelons of power. And so in a sense, it didn't really matter if they misrepresented foreign policy to the population. The point was that they had America's best interests at heart, even if the liberals could not see it. You may remember Paul Wolfowitz, thought to be a Straussian linchpin, as well as the architect of the Iraq War. Others who were there included Abraham Shulsky, a Pentagon intelligence expert, William Kristol, publisher of the Weekly Standard, and Leon Kass. All of them had, in fact, been students of Leo Strauss. This is one perspective on Strauss, and some Chinese Straussians have used Strauss's putative influence with America's leaders to argue that for this reason, he was important enough for the Chinese to study. These days, of course, Strauss is no longer the buzzword for a secret conservative agenda in the US. But there is more to Strauss's thought, of course, than its appearance under these two administrations. Inter alia, his work offered a critique of liberal democracy, a warning about the consequences of elevating rationality to a value in itself, and a recommendation to return to classical works of political philosophy as a place to find the answers to these problems. Most importantly for us, the application of his thought by the Chinese Straussians has evolved over time into a prop for the rapprochement of the CCP and the Chinese Straussians themselves. This rapprochement is all the more unusual in that several of the figures now using Straussian arguments to support Xi Jinping's increasingly autocratic grip on power were once aligned on the side of liberal democracy and protested against the government to that effect. This was the case throughout the 1980s, before the debacle at Tiananmen Square in 1989. While some of the protesters eventually went into jail or into exile, others returned a decade or so after the deaths at Tiananmen with the apparent intention of now allying themselves with the government rather than taking it to task. And among them were the two most famous Chinese Straussians today, Liu Xiaofeng and Ganyang, both of whom we'll definitely return to. As one Bush official remarked in another context, quote, a neoconservative is a left-winger who has been ambushed by reality, end quote. In this case, the remark seems particularly apt. Now, I am not the first to look into the strange phenomenon of Strauss's popularity over the past 20 years. Even my title is a deliberate evocation of an article that appeared in the New Republic some 11 years ago entitled Reading Strauss in Beijing. In that article, Columbia University professor Mark Lilla hypothesized that Strauss was popular in China because he could easily be assimilated into a Confucian tradition that emphasized the role of the educated gentleman in society. On Lilla's view, both Strauss and Confucius saw that a good society needed men who embodied civic virtue and were devoted to the public good. Both Strauss and Confucius believed in the value of an aristocratic government rather than a democratic one, based on the principle that some men were simply better than others. And both touted a version of classical natural rights theory, which was based not on equality, but on an elusive quality called virtue in classical texts and various terms like humaneness and propriety in Confucian ones. That was Mark Lilla. A year later, Tao Wang, at the time a postdoctoral fellow at the Center for American Political Studies at Harvard, likewise wrote on Strauss's popularity in China for the Claremont Review of Books. Tao went to pains to deny that the interest in Strauss had anything to do with politics or nationalism. Instead, he argued that the attraction was mainly philosophical and that the Chinese Straussians agreed with Strauss that many of the main texts of Western philosophy, from Plato to Maimonides to Spinoza, held universal truths now lost to the modern West. All the Chinese had altered was to include Confucius among those classical ancients, granting him the same respect that Strauss had given to the Western philosophers. Nevertheless, the politics is there, especially in our two main Straussians, Gan Yang and Liu Xiaofeng. In his 2002 introduction to the Chinese translation of Strauss's Natural Right and History, for example, Gan Yang emphasized Strauss's insistence on, quote, critically examining Western modernity and liberalism from the perspective of Western classics, end quote. Citing Machiavelli, Nietzsche, and others, Gan Yang paraphrased Strauss's message for any unfamiliar Chinese readers, namely, that Western modernity has turned its back upon its own classics, and that it is now up to China to unite the wisdom of the ancients, both East and West, and to provide a model of that wisdom to the world. As he writes, quote, Western modernity has reversed its moral foundation and now increasingly disrespects ancestors and old age because modern ideas believe only in so-called progress and in the future, end quote. For Gan Yang, as for Strauss, technology and instrumental rationality are the problems that have drained morality out of modern European and American culture. Like Strauss, he suggests that liberal democracies are not viable in the long term because they lack any moral footing to offer their citizens. This emphasis on the ancient versus the modern is important because it changes the political question in case from a comparison of Chinese autocracy versus Western democracy into a comparison of antiquity and modernity, which of course is Straussian, with Confucius and the Western ancients winning hands down over the modern West. We might ask, however, why should we care if the Chinese are reading the Western classics with a Straussian lens? Aren't the classics even less prominent in the public eye in China than in the West? The answer is quite the opposite. And to understand why the Western classics matter in China, we have to understand just how much weight the Chinese assume that the classics have in the West today, which they believe has been shaped inextricably by its classical past. Ironically enough, the importance they bestow on these texts is all the more noteworthy in light of the growing feeling in the US that the works of classical antiquity have little to say to us and may not even deserve a place in our educational system. The reasons for this interest are embedded in Chinese culture, for the Chinese deeply respect their own classics. The texts of the Confucian tradition and to a lesser extent, the Buddhist and Taoist traditions continue to shape Chinese thought and culture. And although the Confucian belief system was denounced by Mao after the CCP's rise to power in 1949, it has since rebounded and is treated as if it has considerable relevance for contemporary Chinese society. Some modern Chinese thinkers, most prominently Du Weiming, are even suggesting that only a return to Confucian values will rescue the Chinese state from its current malaise, as it floats somewhere between its various manifestations as socialism with Chinese characteristics, a market economy, a major political player on the world stage, and even a representation of the tired idea of the other vis-a-vis the West. Today in China, ancient Chinese philosophy is cited in the rhetoric of nationalism and at the highest levels. Confucius's legacy, for example, is deemed important enough that President Xi Jinping regularly quotes him in his speeches. In 2015, 135 of Xi's quotations from classical Chinese philosophy were even published in a book entitled Xi Jinping's Classical Allusions. Most of his quotes come from such Confucian classics as the Analects, the Book of Rites, Mencius, Shunsa, and the Book of History. And they often invoke the duties of the benign monarch in governing the country. For example, one citation that she includes from the Analects reads, quote, "When a prince's personal conduct is correct, his government is effective without the issuing of orders. If his personal conduct is not correct, he may issue orders, but they will not be followed." Presumably, this is meant to reassure the Chinese that however much power Xi may hold, the president's authority is fundamentally moral and not authoritarian. Western scholars, on the other hand, may have Platonic and Aristotelian principles lurking deep in their marrow, but unlike the Chinese, they rarely reflect on it. Many who are not historians or classicists assume that the modern US and maybe Europe too has been shaped comparatively little by these ancient thinkers, and that their greatest moment of influence in American history was during the colonists' struggle for independence, when the founding fathers looked to Greece and Rome for guidance or foil. We in the US expect neither Donald Trump nor Joe Biden to channel Aristotle's Nicomachean Ethics or Plato's Republic, and I hope I am not doing them an injustice in saying so. Even though we live in cultures born out of the Enlightenment and its discovery of ancient knowledge, most of us are comparatively unengaged with that same knowledge. One reason for the Chinese interest in our classics, then, is a case of reasoning by analogy. Looking to the continued vitality of ancient thought in Chinese culture, they assume that the study of Western antiquity is a similarly valuable source of information about the contemporary West, and that modern Westerners are the product of that antiquity. So close is this connection deemed to be that if you look at standard Chinese high school history textbooks, you will see that they simply describe ancient Athens as the source of modern Western democracy, which of course is a significantly misleading statement. However, the sentiment is as old as the writings of the Chinese thinker and reformer Liang Qichao from a century ago, who identified Athens as the source of contemporary Western civilization in his 1902 article on ancient Greek scholarship. The purported tie between classical antiquity and Western modernity, then, has long been seen in China as a useful tool for understanding the West today, which in turn is seen as a project in China's best interests. The Chinese share with Strauss, then, the premise that the classics have something important to say to the present. As I've said, they thought so a century ago too, when understanding the history of the West for that goal, but for the more aggressive goal of outstripping the West. Consider the editorial statement of the Chinese Journal of Classical Studies. Founded in 2010 by the Straussian Liu Xiaofeng, the journal proclaims on its editorial pages that its mission is to interpret the perennial classics of the Chinese, Western, Hebrew, and Arabic civilizations. But its raison d'etre is specifically to use these classics to grasp the future destiny of Chinese civilization, which has been thrown into disarray by modern Western culture. And just to read the editorial statement, as you can see, under the impact of the modern culture initiated by Western civilization, Chinese tradition has been shattered to pieces. For the over 100 years, scholars of our country have faced the yet unfulfilled historical mission to command a profound understanding of Western civilization, the Western classics, and then to restore the spirit of the traditional civilization of China. And in short, the thinking is, if we don't know the classical civilization of the West, we're not going to understand the West, and then we won't be able to understand how to do better than the West in China and how to grasp our future destiny. Here, the reason for the study of ancient Western texts is to benefit China herself, to give China that cutting edge and vision of her future. The mandate here echoes Leo Strauss's views, giving classical texts a political and philosophical importance that cannot really be found in the modern world. As Strauss did, emphasis is put on the tenets of ancient philosophy, pitting absolute moral values as represented by Plato against modern historical relativism. Indeed, the Chinese Straussians are explicit about the location of morality in the Platonic and Confucian traditions and not in the contemporary West. In his essay, Strauss and China, for example, Liu Xiaofeng argues that the mutual encounter of Strauss and China is a meeting between two classical mentalities, and that these two classical traditions, the Confucian one and the Western one, can provide an ethical alternative to the West's annoying and so-called universal values like democracy and equality. In Leo's words, the reason we appropriate Leo Strauss is that modern education does not teach you to distinguish between right and wrong, justice and injustice. Strauss tells us to look at the great works of antiquity, and we should build on them a moral system, whether it's Chinese antiquity or Western antiquity, end quote. Ignoring this imperative, Leo claims, heads indubitably to nihilism, which again is a problem of the West. And I've only just noticed after several years that Leo Strauss and Liu Xiaofeng share the same first name in a way. In contrast to the ancient texts, the modern West then, as both Leo and Gan have argued, is blind. And they cite Strauss to the effect that the Enlightenment's dismissal of religion and revelation in favor of rationalism brought with it a time bomb that eventually exploded, leaving Westerners with no values to cling to. How to backtrack from this precipice? They tell us we must eliminate our modern prejudice that pre-Enlightenment philosophy has little to offer. We must read the ancients and learn from their values. Now, the Chinese Straussians are not the only Chinese to turn to Western classical texts in order to critique the West. This is a quintessential move of the Chinese New Left, who endorse Thucydides' critique of democratic Athens, cite Plato's noble lie approvingly, and suggest that Aristotle's claim that man is at heart a political zoon, a creature of the polis, leads not to human fulfillment, but to the mental slavery of its citizens. All of this is then used to reflect negatively upon liberal democracy. The Chinese venture capitalist Eric Li, for example, practically channels Thucydides when he claims that modern America is plagued by what ailed its political ancestor, classical Athens. In his words, in the New York Times, no less, quote, elected representatives have no minds of their own and respond only to the whims of public opinion as they seek re-election, end quote. He feels that what we lack is a Pericles, somebody far-sighted and strong-willed who could guide the people because he's governed neither by self-interest nor by fear. Li's comparison of the lifespan of Athenian and American democracy leads him to opine, quote, that history does not bode well for the American way. Indeed, faith-based ideological hubris may soon drive democracy over the cliff, end quote. Meanwhile, other neo-leftians look to Plato's ideal city, Kallipolis, and fully agree with the necessity for a noble lie to be directed at the masses. Chang Zhumin, director of the Center for Classical Studies at Southwest University of Political Science and Law, explains that Socrates must use a story as a drug for society because of, quote, the limited nature of most people's cognitive ability and judgment. Not everybody can grasp the truth, and different treatments must be designed according to each person's nature and aptitude, end quote. Chung thus argues that the noble lie exists because human beings need the best people to be rulers, but the same reason they need them is the reason why they can't identify or appoint them. They're simply not smart enough to see what they should be doing. So the Chinese Straussians are in good company and turning to Western antiquity. However, whether or not their critique of democracy is 100% Straussian is very much up for debate. Like the other members of the New Left, as Lei Hua Wang tells us, the Chinese Straussians are immensely interested in finding an alternative to democracy, which is actually not always present in Leo Strauss. Even according to Sadia Drury, no relationship to me, the most vigorous critic of Strauss's political philosophy, Strauss is elitist, but not anti-democratic. However, in the readings of Chinese Platonists, the intention of cultivating an elitist ruling class coexists with a criticism of democracy and a strong urge to find a political alternative in Confucian political tradition and the Maoist heritage. Our Straussian Liu Xiaofeng lays out the stakes quite baldly in a very dramatic quote. A few Chinese intellectuals, he says, need to make a crucial choice, either to continue to be corrupted by Western modern thoughts or to accept re-education through Plato. Re-education through Plato. Imagine an American or British intellectual calling for re-education through Confucius. But we must step carefully because this is Plato as Strauss interprets him, not Plato as he is always understood in the West. One major feature of Platonic re-education is the endorsement of Strauss's view that the philosopher should not speak truth to society. The philosopher is rational and has ideas that are dangerous to society if they are unadulterated. The philosopher will break down the bonds of custom or religion. This is because too much thinking is not conducive to political stability, which demands a strong ruler, says Strauss and the Chinese, who engages in practical rather than theoretical considerations about the good of the state. The Straussian Platonic re-education that Leo calls for a critique of democratic values and also for much hand-wringing about the problems of modernity and the abyss of meaningless that characterizes the West. Finally, re-education through Plato entails believing that Strauss's thought is not an ism. On Leo's view, using Strauss provides Chinese intellectuals with an escape from the latest trends in Western political theories. And when he's asked directly if Strauss's thought is not an ism among the other isms, a theory among the other theories, he answers emphatically in the negative. This answer allows Leo to somewhat disingenuously lay claim to something like a view from nowhere, an Archimedean point from which he and Strauss will view the classical world anew, and this time correctly. Of course, to claim that Strauss does not represent an ism is bold, given that Strauss's interpretations all seem to be united by the essential theme of the tension between truth and social values, between philosophers and politicians, and between antiquity and modernity. And that Strauss roots this theme in his readings of classical texts via a paradigm that is dependent on his famous distinction between esoteric writing and exoteric writing, or esoteric reading and exoteric reading. For the unfamiliar, this was a contrast in methods that Strauss grounded in his interpretation of Maimonides' Guide for the Perplexed, in which he argued that Maimonides wrote for two audiences at the same time in order to avoid persecution. A non-Straussian audience, says Strauss, would read Maimonides as trying to reconcile Aristotle with rabbinical Jewish theology. In Strauss's interpretation, this is merely the surface or exoteric meaning of the text. In fact, Maimonides is covertly saying that philosophy and revelation are not reconcilable. But he had to do the esoteric method to say this because in his historical context, it was too dangerous for him to preach out loud that rationality and religion were not reconcilable. Because the search for truth always destabilizes the political world, which must offer its citizens stability based on shared laws and customs, what Strauss calls nomoi, the philosopher must hide his message, a theme that recurs in Strauss's subsequent discussions of classical thinkers such as Plato, Aristotle, and Xenophon. Are the Chinese then bowing to a Western interpretive model and adopting Strauss to think with? They say they are not. For example, Leo argues against the idea that Strauss's distinction here between esoteric and exoteric presents a Western model for interpretation, because he says there is support for these concepts already in the classical Chinese tradition. For example, in Confucius' Analects, there is a distinction between wei yan, subtle words, and da yi, big meanings, so that Strauss's view is apparently already endorsed by Chinese antiquity. Likewise, Leo points out that in the history of philosophy, many political or philosophical thinkers have had to hide their views by writing tracts that both revealed and concealed what they actually thought. However, since Strauss's interpretations of all these political philosophical texts always point to the same message, which is that the danger that the philosopher faces danger if he speaks truth to politics, it seems to me that it's difficult for Leo and the others to escape the charge of being under the influence of a very specific ism indeed. What is new among the Chinese Straussians rather than among the Chinese neo-left in general is that they not only turn to the classics with a Straussian perspective, but they also use Strauss's views on the role of the classical philosopher to define their own relationship to Xi Jinping's state. Here, Strauss is useful for a reason that has nothing to do with Confucius, ancients versus moderns, or a belief in the hierarchy of virtue typified by the gentleman. That reason is Strauss's advocacy of esoteric reading. Armed with this tool, the Chinese Straussians can read pretty much what they want to into any ancient text. And in fact, the distinction between exoteric and esoteric writing is the mechanism that enables the Chinese Straussians to position themselves as the philosopher advisors to the Chinese state. I'm going to stop sharing my screen now. Okay, you're stuck with just me. So speaking of Chinese philosophers and their role to the modern Chinese state, you can consider the incessant commentary on the dangerous role of the philosopher in the Chinese Journal of Classical Studies, which I've introduced you to already and whose editor was none other than Liu Xiaofeng, the Chinese Straussian. So in the pages of this journal, we read over and over again in different articles about classical antiquity that, for example, Plato's Republic is not about the possibility of the just city. It's not a text about transcendent values represented by forms or ideas. It's a text about the impossibility of the just city and the philosopher's necessary refusal to participate in politics. It's too dangerous. And also about the necessity for a strong ruler with a strong myth behind him to control his fallible and wayward subjects. Another contributor, Chang Zhemin, who we've met already, writes that the noble lie is justified because there's an internal conflict between the city-state and the philosopher. The philosopher and the state have different orientations, and the philosopher's sacred madness will affect the city-state negatively. Another contributor, Wang Jin, writes in the same journal that philosophy is the pursuit of truth, but when faced with political reality, philosophers must refrain from the drive to pursue universal philosophy in order not to undermine the realistic foundation of political community. And finally, in another example of esoteric reading at work, Zhang Bobo suggests that in the Republic, Cephalus is made to leave the scene early because he cannot be exposed to what follows, which is logical argumentation, from which, as Strauss argues, the political leadership here represented by the aristocratic Cephalus must at all costs be defended. Finally, citing Socrates' death, Leo himself takes it as a proof that a philosopher who shares his truths in the public realm will always face the repercussion of the state. Now, this idea that the philosopher must be very careful to write obliquely because of the danger to him from the state actually makes more sense in the Chinese context than in the Western one, given that the severe restrictions on free speech existed in the Ming and Qing dynasties and in the Maoist era as well. And they are firmly in the culture's memory. But as applied by the Straussian intellectuals, and this is somewhat ironic, esoteric interpretation turns out to support philosophers in broad daylight rather than to suggest they need to hide their opinions from the state. our Straussians believe that they are the successors to Strauss's philosophers, and as such, they need to be mindful of the good of the state. And as good patriots, they will only speak out in support of a strong ruler, even an autocratic one. So what's paradoxical here is that even though they're adopting this Straussian belief in the danger of the philosophers speaking up, they speak up all the time in order to discuss the danger of the philosophers speaking up. Unfortunately, there does not seem to be any sight of the other side of the philosopher, the one that actually is dangerous to the state. And I fear that those philosophers may have all died with Tiananmen Square. So much for Strauss and his Straussian philosophers not speaking truth to power in Beijing. In closing, let me ask then, what is at stake for the West in this argument? Do we need to take these scholars seriously when it's hard for many Westerners to take Strauss himself seriously as a political thinker? Given the necessity of using esoteric reading to discover the claim that we need esoteric reading, as with Maimonides, those who are not in Strauss's camp will find a certain circularity in his procedure. But yes, the Chinese Straussians do deserve our attention. Liu and Gan, in particular, have had a long and high profile in China. And the choice of Strauss, along with Carl Schmitt, whom I'm not talking about today, has something to tell us about contemporary Chinese culture. Because, as Kai Marshall puts it, the interplay of China and Straussianism is never purely scholarly or academic. And the destabilizing context of social and cultural globalization, it is driven increasingly by political dynamics, especially the wish for a new rootedness in Chinese cultures. The authors in the Chinese Journal of Classical Studies may not attract much attention, but Liu and Gan and other prominent Chinese Straussians do, and they have used their exoteric readings to speak in praise of the Chinese government. In the process, one suspects, leaving Leo Strauss behind in the rear view window. Liu Xiaofeng, in particular, has taken a drastic step in this regard recently. In May 2013, he publicly dubbed Mao Zedong as father of the nation, and he has gone on to portray him as the Confucian Chengren, or sage, and as a Platonic philosopher king. This has upset other Chinese scholars who feel it is important to remember the bloodshed and famine of Mao's regime. Adding to the turmoil caused by his pro-Mao position, the epithet father of the nation had so far been reserved for the first president of the Republic of China, Sun Yat-sen. On the view of one Western-trained scholar of the classics in contemporary China, quote, Liu seems to support the legitimacy of the current rule of the Chinese government, as well as its role in preventing the democratization of other countries, end quote. And Ganyang is implicated in the pro-Xi Jinping propaganda as well. A much circulated but anonymous article in 2017 attacked him for being corrupt enough to join the new left and for turning his back on his former liberal allies of the 1980s. Gan was also accused of cherry picking his Western authors and thereby not really representing the West to China in an authentic way. A special source of the anonymous author's ire was Gan's description of the Maoist period as representing equality and justice. Equality is built into the CCP's constitution, but Mao's leadership and his cult of personality, not to mention the horror of the Cultural Revolution, are difficult phenomena to whitewash in the name of equality and justice. All this said, it looks at the end of the day as if the Straussian experiment in China is drawing to an end. These days, Ganyang has abandoned his earlier enthusiasm for Strauss. His new contribution to the public discourse of political philosophy is a plan to recuperate the values of Chinese tradition, value a blending of three bodies of thought that he considers authentically Chinese, thereby once again rooting Chinese culture in authenticity. This is his proposal in Tong San Tong, his latest book, in which he wishes to unite the Confucian tradition, which values elitism and local relationships, the Maoist tradition, to which, as you've seen, he ascribes equality and justice, and the Dongist tradition with markets and competition. And if this seems like a far-fetched combination, we may consider other far-fetched intellectual experiments going on right now with the Chinese New Left, such as the recuperation of Confucius as the first supporter of ecological sustainability, essentially the first green philosopher, a bit of a forced interpretation. Finally, I should let you know that the classically trained professors of Western antiquity scattered across many Chinese universities in departments of history and philosophy generally do not regard this popular Straussian group with much enthusiasm. The Straussian turn of the Straussians and of their students is critiqued as a way of approaching ancient texts without having to become familiar with any of the extant scholarship on them, except for Strauss's scholarship, of course. And the result, they say, is a shallow and insufficiently trained appreciation of the ancient corpus. In a 2015 interview, the classicist Nie Min Li, professor at Renmin University, commented that those who enter the study of Western classical studies through Leo Strauss devote too little of their time to the classics per se and have always approached the field from a political angle. Before these scholars even have time to mature as thinkers, Nie suggests, they turn from their Strauss-influenced explication of ancient philosophy to the traditional Chinese classics, seeing affinities in both and arguing for the creation of a uniquely Chinese form of government that the West would value if it knew its ancient texts better. Such research, as Nie points out, is essentially ideological. The implication of Nie's words is that straight-laced academic classicists, unlike the Straussians, are free of an ideological bent. We may or may not choose to agree with this. But the cost of trying to stay true to classical texts, however, is that the Chinese classicists who are not neo-Straussians remain comparatively invisible to the general public, while the dervishes of ideology sprinkle their Straussian magic onto public discussion of what the state's values should be. The message for us, both in the East and West, is both interesting and troubling. If we classicists, we traditional classicists, cannot make these texts speak to everybody, Western classicists will become increasingly marginalized. And as we leave behind the Chinese Straussians today, we may wonder what sort of interpretive practices await us too in the long term here in the West, if we wish to remain relevant to the issues of the day. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Shadi. That was absolutely fascinating.